An alarming report from the United Nations about the Rohingya minority in Myanmar. It says that 600,000 Rohingya there are living under the threat of genocide. The report was compiled from hundreds of victims and eyewitness accounts. It is not the first time that we've heard that kind of language about the Rohingya, namely the G word. In 2017, the UN said genocidal acts had killed thousands and prompted hundreds of thousands to flee to Bangladesh. The new report will be presented to the agency's Human Rights Council on Monday. I want to bring in Matthew Smith in Cambridge, Massachusetts. He is the co-founder and CEO of Fortify Rights and a fellow at the Carr Center for Human Rights at Harvard University. Matthew, appreciate you joining us. First off, I know that you've seen what the Rohingya are dealing with. You've heard the stories firsthand about the rape and torture and all the horrific stories, the things that they've been through. First off, your reaction to this report.
Thank you, Emra, for having me here today. And yeah, this report is another very useful, very important contribution towards holding perpetrators of genocide and other international crimes accountable. It provides some new information about what the Rohingya people have been dealing with, about the violations, and about the evidence that the fact-finding mission has collected.
And I mean, when was the last time you were out in Cox's Bazar talking to the Rohingya refugees? I mean, what kind of stories have you heard when it comes to genocide? I mean, genocide is a deliberate killing of specific people, an ethnic group, a minority group.
That's right. I actually just arrived here at the Carr Center a week ago, but myself and our team, we've been working on the front lines of these atrocity crimes for several years, actually. And we published a report in July 2018 called They Gave Them Long Swords, which actually helped demonstrate how the Myanmar authorities have, how the Myanmar authorities planned for attacks that ultimately amounted to genocide. It's an attempt essentially to destroy the Rohingya people, and it's still ongoing, which the fact-finding mission is helping to clarify.
We've covered this from the beginning, and yet all we do is continue to hear the brutal stories and of suffering from this minority group and the denials from at the highest levels in the Myanmar government, yet the world isn't reacting the way it should be. Would you agree with that?
I would. We want to see a lot more international action. It's absurd and quite tragic that these violations can take place without more international action. The fact-finding mission has done tremendous work. UN Special Rapporteur Yang He Lee has done tremendous work. But beyond that, Rohingya themselves have done incredible work to ensure that the truth is documented and exposed. And we would reiterate the call of the fact-finding mission for the UN Security Council to urgently refer the situation in Myanmar to the International Criminal Court, or to create an ad hoc criminal tribunal, which it can also do.
In terms of repatriation, I mean, there are 740,000, I think that's the number, of Rohingyas who have left the country because of persecution. And they're in these tent cities. They have nowhere to go. And I mean, do any of them have any plans to go back to Myanmar?
You know, Emra, we haven't talked to a single Rohingya. I haven't spoken to a single Rohingya refugee in Bangladesh who has any hope to go back anytime soon. What the Rohingya people are asking for is for restoration of their full citizenship rights in Myanmar, which were effectively stripped by a law that was put into force in 1982. But beyond that, they want to regain, go back to their original places, to rebuild their lives, to have these draconian restrictions that are placed on their movement in Myanmar and on their livelihoods in Myanmar. They want those lifted. They essentially want what everybody in Myanmar wants, which is basic human rights.
Yeah, and they want to feel safe and feel like they can go back home and feel protected by the government, not persecuted by the government. You were mentioning, Matthew, some new information in this report regarding some of the atrocities that the Rohingya have faced. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, well, I think one thing that stood out was that the fact-finding mission had more than 100 names of perpetrators who are responsible and should be investigated and possibly prosecuted for genocide. This is a much bigger list than what they published in the past. They're keeping the names confidential right now, but they did share that it includes Myanmar military officials as well as civilian officials. And I think that's a very noteworthy point because there are both military and civilian people in mm-hmm. positions of power in Myanmar mm-hmm. who are responsible for these crimes and should be prosecuted.
What needs to happen? I mean, we're so far away from any kind of trials taking place at the ICC. What needs to happen? What steps need to be taken to start seeing people at the civilian level, military level, be held accountable in Myanmar?
Well, you know, the Myanmar authorities could take a number of steps right now. They could provide unfettered access to aid groups. Right now, there are, more than 32,000 actually ethnic Rakhine Buddhist civilians who've been displaced in need of aid. There are Rohingya, more than 128,000 Rohingya who are confined to what essentially amounts to concentration camps in various parts of Rakhine State in Myanmar. They need to return to their homes. They need humanitarian aid, adequate humanitarian aid. But the authorities can also amend the 1982 citizenship law to ensure that the Rohingya's citizenship rights are restored. If they took some of these measures rather than just completely deny all the violations, rather than, you know, deny access to the country for human rights monitors, if they did these things, that would at least provide a measure of hope to the Rohingya people. But right now, the Myanmar authorities have nothing but knee-jerk reactions, knee-jerk denials, and this is partly why the wheels of international justice are starting to mm-hmm. move. Mm-hmm.
Matthew Smith, we appreciate you joining us. Thank you very much. We'll make sure to stay on top of this very, very important story.